Hey guys, what's up? It is week 199. I'm here to do some reviews for you. First, let you guys know that we did a Cat 3 show on the 22 Shots of Moods and Horror. Love Cat 3 movies. Haven't seen as many as I would like, but I'm going to talk briefly about a couple of them during this video. It's kind of a short week. I don't have too many movies to talk about. I've been kind of busy over time, that kind of stuff. And also keep your eyes out and your ears open for the podcast Under the Stairs, Forgotten Jolly. I know one just posted of, it was the final one, the first in the second box set, My Dear Killer. So check that out. I guess we're going to hop into the reviews. And the first one is from Arrow Video. And this is Shogun's Joy of Torture. And this was actually made in 68, 69, if I'm not mistaken. And this director actually, he's been covered a couple times on this show. He's, I always mispronounce names, so I shouldn't bother. But I'm going to try it. Tiro Ishii, Ishia or something like that. I feel really dumb every time I say an Asian or Italian name, even though I'm familiar with the work. I really should put more of a time to learn how to say these things correctly. This director did Horrors of Malformed Men, which is kind of a infamous movie in Japan. He also did a couple other of these movies, which are, it's a strange series. There's like eight or nine movies that are related in this series, and he directed the earlier ones, from my understanding. He did this one, which I think is the first one, Orgies of Edo, which is an anthology kind of torture film. Inferno of Torture, and Yakuza Law, which is a little bit different because it takes place, it's three stories about torture that take place over three different time periods, which I thought was really cool. All these movies open up with these crazy torture scenes that you're like, are these in the movie? Are these, but actually it's just kind of a precursor to the movie. This one has a really interesting structure, a nice wraparound, if you will. The first story involves a story of a brother and sister who they're all they have, and the brother is injured during an accident at work. He is crippled, and the sister can't afford the doctor bill, so a rich kind of guy pays for it, but he's not doing it out of the kindness of his heart, if you understand. So he expects something in return, but the brother is a deep infatuation and love for his sister, or very, you know, disturbing kind of stuff, and of course, tragedy strikes. There's some torture sequences, some revenge aspects, and the ending is pretty gnarly. There's going to be a little clip here, so just listen if you don't want it spoiled, but that ending is pretty crazy. And that's where they introduce the kind of wraparound character, the Manistrate, who's basically looking through these old these kind of books where he sees all these tortures, and he's kind of starts to question the motives of these tortures and thinking that they're probably a little out of line. So that's kind of the wraparound of the story. That's the first story. The thing with the anthologies is you kind of just run down what the stories are and then kind of give some oversight on everything for me. It's kind of a little difficult to talk about. But the second story is, this one's pretty unique. It's kind of a nunsploitation, if you will, kind of deal. We have this story of this, these two, I believe it's a, They're these kind of strange, like, different nuns. I've never seen them, like, dressed like this, and I don't know too much about, you know, the history of, you know, Christianity and not even Christianity, but all the religions and stuff, because I think monks are different qualified. I think they're Christians. Yeah, Christianity in different countries and stuff. There's Buddhist monks, too. So, regardless, there's these nuns that show up to this kind of isolated place, and nearby is a monastery. And these two nuns have a relationship and with each other, and pretty soon one of them starts to focus in on one of the younger men and is completely infatuated with him. And she gets holds something over his head and starts to blackmail him for, you know, her gains. But it all backfires in, you know, revenge and lust and jealousy and all that kind of stuff. And I thought this one was pretty good as well. And there is some violence, especially for 1968. The thing about these movies is when you first start getting into, like, seeing all the different films and the crazy movies and everything like that, a lot of these ones are always brought up. Like, and they were hard to find. There was the Joys of Torture, Inferno of Torture, Orgies of Edo, but there was also Shogun Sadism, which was the Joys of Torture Part 2. There was a slew of these movies, and they were always put on the kind of the crazy, disturbing list, and they were never very easy to find in America. So, like, Arrow putting these out is actually a really awesome to me, because I never thought I would get to see these in a good copy, and the imports were super expensive. So finally getting to see this stuff was being made in the late 60s in Japan and stuff, and these weird kind of long-gated torture sequences are wild. And then they would obviously be used in the Dakota Tokusatsu erotic films movies like Flower and Snake and Pinky films and all sorts of stuff. So these are kind of like the beginning of it, and I imagine that they predate earlier to other things like that. And the final story in here is one, I should mention that in this final story, one of the characters from the end of the second story is brought in, and he kind of is in the end of that story. He's into a character in this story too. This one follows a tattoo artist, and tattoo artists are completely different in this kind of time period and in these films. They like kind of tattoo a lot of these women and everything like that, and a lot of them, the women were prostitutes, and they tattoo all over their bodies and everything like that. So these tattoo artists are very taken very seriously in their art, as you know, kind of very important. And one day this guy is tattooing this image of this woman being tortured on somebody, and the kind of war general or whatever says that's not how the agony is in their faces. This is a terrible tattoo. So the tattoo artist becomes obsessed with capturing that agony, and there's a nice twist on this one, and I thought this one was really solid how it played out. So it comes together pretty well. I enjoyed this whole entire series. I mean, this whole, all three of the anthology shorts, and I think the last one probably has the best payoff, although I think the second one might be a little bit more up my alley in terms of content and the endings and all that kind of stuff. But all three are very good, and I would recommend checking this out. I'm going to pick up the back and cheat a little bit. I try to memorize all the features and the stuff I watched, I feel like I missed something, and I feel like that's a very unfair because there's a lot of hard work put into these. So there's an audio commentary by Japanese cinema expert Tom Mez, who's on a bunch of these Arrow releases. I know he's done some of the other ones, the Shinya, the Solid Metal Nightmares box set. See, I didn't embarrass myself that time. And also there's an erotic grotesque maestro talking about the newly filmed interview with author Patrick Massassi's Massas, M-A-C-I-A-S, see, terrible. I have to hear last names pronounced out loud once before I can basically, you know, get them all. So I'm like Duncan McLeish on podcast. I'm just terrible, terrible names. But and then there's also a Bind Torture Thrill. Author and critic Jasper Sharp discusses the history of torture in Japanese exploitation cinema. And I watched this one. I thought this one was really interesting. I've seen him pop up in a bunch of the other features. I want to say he was on the JSA special features as well. But he goes down and he talks about how Pinky films had to be independent to be considered Pinky films. So when people call these kind of torture films by the bigger studios like Toei and stuff, Pinky films, he's like, that's not really accurate. And I thought that was interesting. You learn something new every day. And I'm continuing on my journey of being a full-blown pervert and learning these things about these movies. But anyways, this is a very good movie. And he also mentions, like, I don't think that this was completely done seriously. I think there is somewhat of, you know, a tongue planted in the firmly in the cheek, you know, somewhat or a little bit, that these are kind of self-aware of how ridiculous they are. And they do feel a little bit crazy and almost, I don't want to say pulpy, but you know what I mean. Like, they aren't 100%, like, I don't feel like their intent is to just be completely cruel in any ways. But if you like Japanese films and you like the torture stuff and you like twists and anthologies, these are fairly interesting. This one was really good, but I'd recommend checking out all the ones that they put out so far. Orgies of Edo, and I can't remember Inferno and Torture. It's more of an elongated story, but I don't know if it's 100% anthology, but that one as well, and Yakuza Law, and am I missing any? Whores and Malformed Men is a very bizarre film, and definitely acquired taste. But check out all his films. Arrow's doing a good job with these. And hopefully we get Shogun Sadism and a couple of these other ones to finish out the whole series, because I definitely want to check those out too. So yeah. Okay, this next one is from Full Moon Entertainment, and this is The Hand That Feeds the Dead. And this stars the legendary Klaus Kinski. We all love Klaus Kinski. Maybe not personally, but we all love watching Klaus Kinski, let's put it that way. And it's directed by Sergio Garoni, this guy did a couple of the Nazi exploitation movies, some of the really sleazy, cheesy ones, and I can't, to be honest, that's one of the hardest genres for me, the subgenres, to keep straight, because they're all named like SS Hellcamp, SS Hellcamp Experiment, SS Helltrain. They're all the same titles, besides, of course, Ilsa. But when you get to the Italian ones and even the French Nazi exploitation movies, they all blend together. And besides, like, Beast in Heat, because that's a different name. But anyways, this director kind of dabbled in some of those movies as well. He did spaghetti westerns. His name is kind of, like, known in the Italian exploitation genre. So The Hand That Feeds Death, I put this in and I was like, man, I'm having flashbacks to a lot of movies that I had watched recently. Klaus Kinski is married to a woman whose father, with the last name Rasimov, which I thought was really funny because Ivan Rasimov, you know, a famous kind of actor, appeared in a bunch of these Italian horror films. But Rasimov was her father. He's died. Klaus Kinski married the daughter, and the father died in some kind of experiment gone wrong. And the daughter constantly is walking around in a black veil. You think maybe because she's... you know, mourning the death. But Klaus Kinski has some people come over to his, basically a mansion castle, kind of very gothic style thing. And we have what seems to be an eyes without a face kind of going on, where there's experiments and parts being taken for other things. And we kind of put two to two together. And after watching Castle of Creeping Flesh a couple weeks ago with the Howard Vernon and Eyes Without a Face a while back, you're just like, yes, we're seeing all these kind of constant tropes of, you know, and even Dr. Fives, which we watched the sequel to that a while ago. It's very much that kind of film, where we have somebody trying to correct or fix a loved one in a gothic mansion where people are being picked off. Surprisingly, this Kinski performance is a little bit more reserved than I expected, because when I see Kinski, I'm like, oh no, somebody's going to get hurt on set or in real life. But I feel like this is a little bit more reserved until the very ending, where he has this really good kind of monologue with a doll, and he like kind of spills his guts out and everything like that. I thought that was fairly well done. I do think this one is a little bit uneventful for me. I like the reveal. I like, you know, this kind of storyline, but maybe I've been watching a little bit too much of these movies lately with the, you know, kind of experiments in the mansion gothic stuff. I do typically enjoy these, but this one just didn't have enough oomph or difference to make it stand out for me. Unfortunately, there is another movie that Full Moon's putting out that is by the same director, released the same month with Klaus Kinski, with the Rasimov family name in it, called Lover of the Monster. These are two different movies that are not related, except that they're probably shot on the same set using some of the same scenes and all that kind of stuff. So I'll probably be covering that one in the future, but do not be confused. Hand That Feeds the Dead and Lover of the Monster are not the same film, and they're not sequels, although they sure seem like it, because they both star Klaus Kinski, and they use the same cast and the same sets and stuff, but it's not. This one is in Italian. You cannot watch it in English, and I do typically like to watch my Italian movies dubbed in English, because the actors on set that were English or spoke English are speaking their native languages, but we only have Italian, so yeah. And I'm not sure if there's even any American actors or English actors in this film anyways, but I know Klaus Kinski is not Italian, so anyways, check out The Hand That Feeds the Dead. I know he's not American either, so I thought they remastered it fairly well, and it looked really good, but it's just a little uneventful for an Italian horror film for me. Sorry. Okay, I'm gonna be fairly brief with this one. This is The Untold Story Part 2. We do cover on the 22 Shots of Moods and Horror, so I'm gonna be brief. I just want to talk about it on my channel, because I don't think I'll ever get a chance to talk about this any other time except this show. So yeah, this one I think was made fairly late. It's not the same director. Herman Yao does not direct again, but I think Danny Lee is producing. It does star Anthony Wong again, but in a completely different role. It's not really a direct sequel or anything like that. None of the characters pop up, but it does share a lot of similar themes and moments in here. Okay, so the plot is as follows. We have kind of a pushover husband who is, you know, I guess he runs a restaurant, and his wife is very pushy, very highly sexually charged, but he does not care for her because she's so mean and she's constantly cheating on him. So he's impotent with her. So she constantly badgers him, cheats on him. One day, a cousin from the mainland China, they're in Hong Kong in this, decides to come over and stay with them. Immediately, the cousin starts to kind of pull her strings and seduce the owner of the restaurant and that kind of stuff. I love this because instead of having Anthony Wong be like the kind of crazy guy murderer, we have more of a villainess here, and she's very sadistic and has these mental problems, and her performance is great. There's definitely a classism thing going here with against, you know, the mainlanders and the Hong Kongers and stuff like that. People from Hong Kong are kind of looking down on the mainlanders, and there's a really great scene involving a bathroom moment, which I thought was fantastic. Wong's really fun in it. He's a cop. He kind of feels like he's reprising a role kind of like from A Lamb from Despair or any of the other kind of roles. Definitely kind of total opposite of his role in The Untold Story, more in line with you know, a baffling kind of idiot, you know, because I would say in Bullet Syndrome he's a bigger moron, although very violent and evil. But anyways, he's playing a completely different role here. more of a comedic one. Yeah, I think this one's pretty decent. I enjoy it. It's filled with nudity and it has a fair share of violence and a couple of the heavy hits that we have in the Untold Story, like cannibalism, restaurant stuff, people being set on fire. So yeah, check it out. There is an HD or Blu-ray out there from Yes Asia. It's very expensive to import. But yeah, it's around $27.99 or $27 or something like that. If I had unlimited funds, I would be importing all the Cat 3 movies from there, including Robotrix and Erotic, Stories or Chinese. What is that one called? There's a whole series of them. But anyways, check out Untold Story. I'll probably throw some clips. Part 2, I'll probably throw some clips in here. And there is an Untold Story Part 3, which I think is less graphic than the other two for sure. The first Untold Story is a masterpiece. This one's good. It has a lot of, it has to live up to a lot. But I still think it's pretty good, so check it out. Okay, next on the slate is Ebola Syndrome, and I actually watched this on iTunes. Apple TV has, I believe, the uncut version, because I double checked on my DVD of the Untold Story to rent or buy. So yeah, I definitely watched it, a 4K master or whatever, remastered on iTunes or Apple TV. But Ebola Syndrome is the follow-up, directed by Herbert Yao, to The Untold Story, made in 1996, starring Anthony Wong, of course. Geez, boy oh boy. This is definitely trying to recreate the magic of Untold Story. It has very similar opening in the past, and a criminal escaping and fleeing to a different place, and child murder, and all that kind of stuff, like semi-accidental start of a killing spree with child murder, all that kind of. But this is a really weird movie. So Anthony Wong plays a criminal, pretty similar to the character he played in The Untold Story. He ends up committing a murder and flees to South Africa from Hong Kong. And while he's in South Africa, he ends up getting a job at a restaurant. The funny thing is, he smells horrible, so everybody always comments on how bad he smells. And soon enough, he decides to, when they go to pick up some pigs from a tribe, just to get a better price on it, there's an Ebola outbreak, and he gets separated from his boss, and he decides to rape this poor dying woman on the side of the river. He contracts Ebola, but he does not understand, or he does not know that he is like the 1 in 10 million people that is immune to it and is spreading Ebola. So we have this psychopath, crazy person, who ends up going on this crime spree, killing spree, that is spreading Ebola wherever he goes. So we have this kind of the double exploitation or triple exploitation angle here, like where the exploitative things of Ebola, so people are paranoid about Ebola, which was kind of interesting to watch this during, you know, COVID-19 times. Then we have the horrible murders that he's committing and rapes and stuff and high sexual content. And then on top of that, we have the whole restaurant people being fed other people deal that we had from Untold Story. So Anthony Wong in this is absolutely great. He's in insane, almost a little bit more comedic than his role in the first one in Untold Story. But I must admit that it was kind of, I don't know if it's a translation issue. I can't think it necessarily means bowling, or bowling has a different kind of meaning in Hong Kong or China. But he keeps calling that everybody's bullying him, and he's just like a complete sociopath and will not take responsibility. He justifies everything he does. But without spoiling too much, this one does get really graphic with the murders and the rape and stuff. I would say Untold Story, I don't know, this one's more insane, I would think, because at the end climax of what happens here is just completely bonkers, and you would never expect something like this to, you know, ever happen in a movie today. Regardless, I've always enjoyed this one. This is a rewatch. I think Untold Story is a better film, probably because this one feels so much like it's trying to recreate everything that happened in Untold Story. But if I can get more Untold Story, I am very happy. But there is some unintentional comedic moments, like especially when the Americans are speaking in English. They're like obviously dubbed, and it just sounds really poor. But that kind of stuff. But Anthony Wong is such a sleazebag in it. And at this one point, he goes incognito and he's wearing this stupid mustache. And it's just a hilarious movie and very gross at the same time, where you're like, oh, because you know he has Ebola and you're just waiting for him to spread it and everything like that. But check this one out. I've always enjoyed it. It's a crazy, crazy movie, and I hope it gets a Blu-ray release stateside. It's definitely in need of it. More Hong Kong movies on Blu-ray. Okay, the next one is one I watched on Shudder. It's a 2020 movie, and it is The Queen of Black Magic, and this is a remake from one from the 80s, an Indonesian film. And I know that one is also aka Black Magic 3, and a lot of people are saying, well, it's part of a series, and I don't know if that's 100% accurate, to be honest. I think that it probably was just released in a different country as Black Magic 3, probably as a sequel to, or trying to cash into a sequel to, the Shaw Brothers films, Black Magic and Black Magic 2. So if anyone knows the exact details on this, I feel like that's probably more accurate, that they just used the Black Magic name, and we're like, we'll call this Black Magic 3. I don't know if it's 100% true, or if there is an entire series dedicated to this, but I've heard that a couple times, and I just can't see it, because so many of these movies that are released in different territories just take a sequel name to get recognition or anything like that. So I don't know if this is related. Maybe it's the same production company, but I don't know if this one, the original Queen of Black Magic, has anything to do with the Shaw Brothers, one being Indonesian and one being, you know, Chinese and stuff like that. So anyways, I just thought I'd point that out, because I've been hearing that a few times. But I've never seen the original Queen of Black Magic. It is on Shudder right now, and I have the Mondo Macabro DVD. Hopefully it gets a Blu-ray release. It might. It's a good chance. But so anyways, The Queen of Black Magic. This is written by Joko Adwar, who directed Satan's Slaves and Impetigore, which were both fantastic movies in the last few years. And it's directed by one of the Kimo and the guys that were involved with stuff like The Night Comes for Us. They both branched off and are doing their own movies now, it seems. But it's directed by not the one who did the most recent one directed stuff. But I can't think of which one it is, to be honest. It's Kimo, the Kimo, I can't remember their name. Sorry about that. But regardless, the other one did that made The Devil Take You and made The Devil Take You Too. So The Queen of Black Magic. I put this in and I had heard some reviews here and there, mostly positive. So I figured I'd enjoy this. This is definitely up my alley because, like I said, I like these foreign supernatural movies because they take a different approach to the ghost story or to the possession or to, you know, magic. Typically, we don't have very many American horror films with magic or dealing with that kind of stuff, except maybe like The Witch, which is, it's kind of witchcraft, different kind of deal in general. But this one is super, super bizarre. But it's very typical of the movies we've seen by them before. So, anyways, we have this these people that grew up in an orphanage, and they become like a family unit. There's 3-4 of them. One still lives at the orphanage with his wife. They're all married. They all have families of their own, and they all kind of head back to honor the dying person that used to run the orphanage that they look to as like their main father figure. So they end up showing up to this orphanage, and you know, you can see the different. There's a lot of character development. You kind of learn who these characters are, learn about, you know, their imperfections and the stuff that they're, you know, kind of worried about. And as it goes on, there's a story told about this. There's this picture shown about this woman who used to live there who died under unfortunate circumstances. And one of the young boys learns the legend of it and everything, and learns that there's home video of her. And that plays into one of the best scares I've seen in a very long time, involving a television set and the reflection when it shuts off. That's a fantastic scare, really genuinely well done. So anyways, strange things start to happen when they find a bus on the side of the road with some horrible stuff in there, which I was kind of shocked was in there, although I'd heard about it. And of course, there's nasty bugs, including centipedes crawling through people's mouths and orifices and manipulating them, and true body horror. Most of that stuff, if not all of it, is CGI, but I think it looked fairly decent and it made my skin crawl and it was fairly gross. But there's some really gnarly stuff in here. I liked the story. I liked how it unfolded. These ones usually do have a huge reveal where it's not as it seems and does it really well. Like the isolated location, like the characters, no complaints. Really solid, creepy horror film. Couple of the best scares I've seen in a very long time. And that TV scare has to be one of the best TV scare I've seen since, like, The Ring, maybe? And a lot of people are like, oh, that's a lot of praise. But it really got me. I did not expect it. But, yeah, there's some gnarly, nasty stuff in The Queen of Black Magic. Recommended. Good stuff. Check it out. Okay, the next one is the Patreon pick from my friend Dan the Cameraman. And he picked Disconnected by Gorman Belchard, who did Psychos in Love. This is 1983. This is before. This still stars Carmen Capianco, RIP. Very great guy, very funny, always loved him. But Disconnected, I'm glad Vinegar Syndrome got a chance to put this one out. At a long time, this one never got released. I think at one point it was supposed to be put up by Rare Flicks or Media Blasters, and then it was kind of canceled, and everybody's like, ah, man, that sucks, because I've always wanted to check it out, and it's kind of billed as an early slasher film, but it's super bizarre. Okay. You can see, like, the makings of Psychos in Love in here, some of the comedic beats, but mostly the weird kind of interview structure they have at points. So, there's this girl who's in a relationship, and she has a twin sister, and her twin sister's always kind of getting involved with the relationship and ruining it. She works at a video store, and then one day this kind of young, very polite but very strange man comes in and asks her on a date, and right off the bat you're like, this guy is crazy. Earlier in the film, though, she had this weird interaction with an older man who asked to use her phone. And right after that, there's just these weird phone calls after she meets both these people. So you're like, they have to be related, this old man, this guy coming into her shop. And she starts to get these strange phone calls. And they kind of show their cards a little bit on some of the twist here, where they show that guy is a killer. So you're basically just waiting for this thing to happen. But what's cut in here a lot is the police trying to help her out and everything with Carmen. Well, they're trying to look for not necessarily helping her out yet, but they're trying to look for the killer and everything like that. So we're cutting to them, and there's these funny bits of Carmen eating like this sub and making it almost seems like improv. He's like, this sub's terrible. And it's like, it tastes like somebody had already eaten it, and just stuff like that I love. And I love the kind of like interviews with them, because they use it in Psychos and Love, and it's freaking perfect in that. But the interviews and stuff, and him just kind of talking about his inner monologue, and there's these kind of offbeat jokes too. They're like, why do you dress like that? Because he's wearing a Hawaiian shirt. He's like, why are you asking me that? It felt so natural. I love seeing that. Just always wish that he was in more films. So when I see him in films, I'm always excited. So there is some murder sequences in here. Obviously, this killer has a sexual thing with the kills and everything. And the twin sister aspect is a bit cheesy, but I guess it's, understanded. And like I said, there's some sex scenes. But another thing that really kind of interested me, it's not like a gore fest. The special effects aren't fantastic or anything. And it doesn't have the humor that Psychos in Love has. But it has some decent camera work for a low-budget film. I think this was shot on 16. It looks very grainy and cheap, which is an aesthetic I like. But the thing that really stood out to me was the music. And the music was actually good. It was really good. It was really catchy. They used it at the right spots. And it also has like a 15 minutes. You think the movie's done, but it's not, and there's some more twist, and you realize that it's not just such a straightforward horror film as you thought it was. There are some special features on here. There is the director, an older short part of it at least, I believe, on here. There's an introduction with Carmen and Gorman, and then there's an interview with Gorman where he talks a little bit about the movie, not wanting to release it necessarily, and then there's an interview with Carmen too, and he mentions that people would always come up to him at conventions and be like, what about Disconnected? When's Disconnected? And they were very shocked that people still really liked it. So yeah, it's a nice release from Vinegar Syndrome. I would check this one out if you haven't seen it. If you like Psychos and if you love Psychos in Love, you'll like Disconnected. It's not in tone, but you can see kind of like, you know, a little bit of the stuff starting before, you know, getting kind of Psychos in Love on the right track to be made, which I love the movie. It's definitely on my alley. But yeah, Disconnected. I did enjoy it, and I'm glad I watched it. At first I was like, I don't know about this, and then the music, You Don't Love Me. I was like, I started really enjoying it, and I would check this one out. So yeah, Disconnected. And like I said, I do like cheap looking movies, so this one was totally up my alley. Okay, now we're going to hop into Survive 05, and this is The Skeleton Key, which I think I saw parts of this when it was originally released, and I couldn't remember everything about it. I know the story is that this one was released kind of around the same time as Katrina, and it kind of took some slack because it was a down south kind of hoodoo story, and I guess people really didn't want to see that kind of thing at the time. So we have this young girl who is, you know, she works in like old person facility taking care of old people. She has like this backstory with, you know, kind of feeling like she neglected her father. So she's always constantly trying to make up for that and fix the problems that she had. So she takes this job kind of in an isolated, like, southern mansion, taking care of an old man played by John Hurt. And she has to deal with his wife, who's very weird and superstitious, played by Gina Rowlands, which blew my mind she was in this. And so basically that's what happens at first. And right off the bat, you know, something's fishy because John Hurt can't talk. And then she starts to kind of like do some snooping and kind of starts to understand that something happened in the attic. Then she's looking into everything. And there's this old story about these slaves being killed for dabbling in magic and all this kind of stuff. And I think that this one would get better on a rewatch right away, because you would start picking up on a lot of cool details and you're like, oh, they set that up really well. And it's much more sinister than one would actually expect it to be. And the ending is really dark and really twisted. The setting's great. I love these kind of southern gothic horror films. The acting is really solid, especially by John Hurt and Gina Rowlands. And there's a lawyer character, and I will say everything with the lawyer is super telegraphed. It's very obvious. He's a very obvious character, and that is kind of one thing where you're like, okay, we know exactly where this is going with him, and it's kind of iffy on that. But everything else I thought was really great. I thought the acting was great. I thought that this backstory with her was a little bit very kind of, hey, it is what it is, but they kind of needed to set up why she would care so much about these characters. Anyways, it's a really dark ending, and it's twisted and different too. And I think that this one probably would have got more love in 2020 than it did in 2005. But Skeleton Key, I would be very surprised if this wasn't on at least two or three people's top 10 list of the year. It certainly deserves to be. It's a very good movie. It's just not exactly up my alley because I am a trash bag person and I like trashy things, but this is objectively one of the better movies of the year. It's just I like it. It's just I don't know if it will be gracing my top 10, but objectively it's probably one of the best. But I'd rather watch stuff like Chaos from last week, right? Okay, diving into more Survival 5. Speaking of trashy films, we have Rob Zombie's The Devil's Rejects. Okay, like last week, it was the thing with Serbian film where it's like, oh, just put the thumbs down. Okay, I'm a Rob Zombie fan. I've enjoyed his music. I've enjoyed most of his movies, except, 31. And I don't love the Three from Hell. I think it's okay. So here we go. I feel like I know a lot of people complain, like, you got to talk about every single Rob Zombie thing when you talk about Rob Zombie, and that is obviously a thing. But let me just say this very quick. I think if Rob Zombie didn't touch the Halloween movies, he'd probably get a lot less hate. When just his name on a Halloween remake, it rubs people a lot in a really bad ways. But okay, The Devil's Rejects is a sequel to House of a Thousand Corpses. It's completely different in style and tone. Instead of kind of being like the trippy horror movie thing, it's more of a almost on the run western looking style, gritty 70s exploitation movie, which is totally up my alley. I love the look of it, and I know how I constantly complain about the editing of 2005 movies, but for some reason the editing in this movie really works for me. The freeze frames and there's also an element of slow motion. And immediately when I think of slow motion and shootouts and kind of the freezing the frame and hearing the gunshots and all that kind of stuff, although it's not as well done as the master Sam Peckinpah, it definitely reminds me of that. And you guys know how I feel about The Wild Bunch and Bringing the Head of Alfredo Garcia and a couple other of his films. I think they're masterpieces. I love them. So when we see this opening shootout in the very beginning, and I'm not saying it's as good as The Wild Bunch, so don't put that in my mouth. I'm not saying it is, but that kind of almost that freezing and that weird style, the style of editing, for somehow it works in 2005 in this movie. And like, I know that people will be like, but is there much difference between the editing in Feast and Death Tunnel? And I do think there is. I think those are more jarring and whip pan like editing cuts in the middle, and that is here too. But for some reason I think maybe the camera works a little bit better, and I think maybe it gives you time to get into that intense moment. I don't know. Maybe I'm being a hypocrite and I was just nitpicking those movies unfairly. I don't know. Sometimes I think that people do that and they refuse to say that they're doing that and just stand their ground and die on that hill and be hypocrites. But I will admit, sometimes people can be hypocritical. Maybe I am here and there. Very wishy-washy today, right? So I am a big fan of it. Basically, the Fire Fan clan is on the run, and leading this charge to track them down is William Forsythe, whose brother was Tom Tolles from the original. So he's got this kind of vendetta against them. And his character arc is really interesting because he kind of is this mean kind of sheriff. Somewhat likable, to be honest, in the very beginning, but he's saying to himself, I'm walking the line, brother, I'm walking the line. But he definitely wants to get this revenge, and as you start to see this kind of turn in him and more vile and more violent and everything when he goes after this clan. And we see the clan, Otis, Baby, and Captain Spaulding together start off as monsters, and they're always monsters and they're always bad people, but you start to add these human qualities in them while you take away human qualities from Sheriff Wydell. So I always like that. I like that it's shot the way it is. I like where it's shot. I think that there's, it just looks gritty and nasty, and it looks kind of like a Western, which I'm a sucker character for. And another thing that I absolutely adore about it is the character actors. This is a movie where we get kind of great character actors like William Forsythe, who is a totally underrated actor. He's always fantastic in everything he's done. He's been in a lot of big movies, from The Frickin' Rock, Virtuosity, but Once About a Time in America. He's fantastic in Dear Mr. Gacy and Dick Tracy, Things to Do in Denver When You're Dead. He's one of these guys that I don't register as one of my favorite actors until I start naming the stuff he's in, and I'm like, no, he is a fantastic actor, and he is truly terrifying in Dear Mr. Gacy. It's one of the most uncomfortable performances I've ever seen given as a serial killer, but he's so good in this movie. He's captivating and scary and just great. But it takes these character actors, like I said, William Forsythe and Jeffrey Lewis, who is so good in this movie. I remember when I was watching this film back in the day, this is in 2006 or so, I was watching it in the living room, and my dad walked in. I was just like 18, 19. And my dad's like, he saw some of the violence in it, and then he saw Jeffrey Lewis, and he's like, what's he doing in this? Because, you know, my dad watched the, you know, the Clint Eastwood movies, like, High Plains Drifter or anything back in Jeffrey Lewis popping up in, like, Culpeper County. I'm sure my dad's seen a lot of Westerns with Jeffrey Lewis, so when he saw him, he's like, what's he doing in this? Kind of shocked that he was in this nasty movie, and I always got a kick out of that. But he's fantastic in it as this kind of traveling band, along with Lou Temple and Priscilla Barnes, and they're just fantastic together. And Brian Posey as their frickin' a roadie. So like I said, it has these classy character actors, and like, I guess Jeffrey Lewis isn't super classy being in stuff like 10 to Midnight, but and William Forsythe. And then it mixes in like the character actors that I loved growing up, like Michael Berryman and Sid Haig and Ken Foree. And of course, then we have Tom Tolles is in here as well, one of my all-time favorites, and Bill Moseley. And I know a lot of people complain about Sherry Moon Zombie. I like her, and she's one of these characters, you know, I know a lot of people are like always complain about the people putting their wife in the films, whatever. I've always enjoyed her, okay? And honestly, when you're put in that position, would you not do the same thing? Probably would. I bet you would. But hey, you're not, so you're mad at it. I'm sorry. And I know that there is a legitimate group of people that can't stand Rob Zombie's movies. And I understand. I know that not everyone's doing it just to be different or just to stand out. But I truly do like most of his movies. And this is my favorite of the bunch. There's some really disturbing stuff in here, to be honest. And there's one moment where I'm like, bullshit. If you're ever kidnapped by people at gunpoint and they kill one of you right away, fight for your life. Because they kill one of you, they're most likely not going to let you live, right? But if they're crazy, you never know. But still, after a character is shot point blank in the hotel room, that's when I stand up and get shot right then. I'm getting wasted right on the spot because I'm not... Never let them tie you up. Henry Zebrowski, last podcast left. Never let them tie you up. Never. That's good advice. Never let them tie you up. But the ending also ends with a fantastic use of Freebird, which is so on the nose. Like, you're so on the nose, like the redneck anthem and Freebird, and you're just like, I'm enjoying watching these trashy people. Are we really? I don't want to say all rednecks are trash. I'm just saying, you know what I mean? It feels like it's on the nose to put Freebird in that movie, and you're just like, come on now. But it works, and I can't believe it works. And I know a lot of people are upset that they made a sequel to this, and I just watch this as if I stand alone when I watch it. I don't think of the sequel. To be honest, I do. I'm not thinking the Three from Hell. I'm just not. I feel like I take it that way. But, and also another thing that really helps this movie, it truly does, and Tarantino is excellent at it too, is needle drops. He's so popular that he has that connection, or that he can get to, you know, independent, you know, record labels, not independent. He's not like independent people where they can't use the music they want. So Tarantino can drop these great songs in needle drops. And Rob Zombie has that tie to the, you know, the music industry. So the soundtrack here is fantastic with the Allman Brothers and Joe Walsh and all sorts of stuff like that. And the freaking Leonard Skinner, just lots of big like needle drops that fit perfectly to the time, and they work really well in that kind of southern kind of that way. So I know that there's probably a lot of people that adore this movie, and there's a lot of people that hate this movie, and there's a lot of people that I think like it but are probably embarrassed to like it. And I don't want to say that this, because every movie's going to have a fan base that not necessarily everybody loves, but I could see, like, I don't want to sound like I'm talking down on anybody or anything, but I could see a lot of snooty people saying they are scared to admit they like this because they know that a lot of us regular folk like it too. They've like, and they probably think that regular folk like it for negative reasons, like, ah, I love them rapist killers. And it's just like, I don't know, I just find it really interesting in the aspect that we're taking this cop who is really somebody who lost somebody he loves and's trying to do the right thing, turning him into a monster, and we're taking these criminals who are awful, awful monsters and turning them into a likable. And obviously the turn is a 2D free scene. Sid Haig is great in this. This is one of his finest moments. Love Sid Haig. And two, I don't think Bill Moseley and Sid Haig have ever been better. I'm gonna be honest. And the interactions between Ken Foree and Sid Haig are some of my favorite moments. They're so good together. Like the chemistry is through the roof with them. But no, I really like this. And I do not like some of the CGI knife and stuff, but I that scene with Baby and Jeffrey Lewis Roy, and he's like, say that again. It's just so dead on, like for the kind of old kind of guy to do that kind of deal. I really could see somebody doing that. Oh, my wife's in that room. Just I love this movie. And the way Otis, he before he takes out and kills somebody, he literally emotionally like degrades and destroys Roy before he's gonna physically destroy Roy. He says, "Do you like this song?" And he says, "I thought you were a tough as fuck country guy. You ain't nothing but a cowboy." And you're just like, "Wow, that's just such a cruel bet right there." You know what I mean? And it shows that his he's an evil bastard. Also, I do like how they kind of reused the line from the Manson family. They switch it around a little bit. "I'm the devil. I'm here to do the devil's work." Originally, supposedly, Tex Watson said, "I'm the devil, and I'm here to do the devil's business." So, obviously, a tie-in there. But anyways, the editing style reminds me a bit of Natural Born Killers, which I'm a sucker for. Which is so weird that I love Natural Born Killers editing, but I get annoyed by 2005 editing. Hypocrite, I'm a hypocrite. Yeah, anyways, I love the Devil's Rejects. I know it's not everybody's cup of tea. It's just like, I know people are probably like, "Dave, you're losing it, man. You're like, you love chaos, you love Devil's Rejects, you love Serbian film. What's next?" You know, I'm gonna come on and be like, I love Cuties, it's my favorite. Oh, I'm kidding, I didn't watch Cuties. Not that I care if people watch it or not, it's none of my business. I'm just not interested. But anyways, Devil's Rejects, love it. Sorry, not sorry. All right, we're here for a blind spot. And this is one of your picks.
Yeah.
And this is It Came from Outer Space.
With a deadly pace.
Yeah, no, stop it. This is the last. Is this actually the last of the songs? I think it is from
It
the
might
Rocky
be,
Horror.
Because I got Martin and.
Yeah, you have
that
Martin
might be it.
And. No, you have Arsenic and Old Lace too.
Oh, yeah.
That's probably
I'm
another
for that
one.
One.
Next week, before I forget, is The Hour of the Wolf, which is my pick, the Bergman movie. So, It Came from Outer Space. This was what, 51, 52?
Something like that.
This is before. This is Jack Arnold, who did Tarantula, Creature from Black Lagoon, and The Incredible Shrinking Man. All really good movies. I've always loved the creatures, my favorite Universal Monster, and Incredible Shrinking Man I saw as a kid on television and always loved it.
That was the original Ant-Man, as
Yeah,
told by my drunk
as
dad.
told by your drunk father, as we remember from the rest of the blind spots.
Yes.
So, do you want to give the plot on this one since you picked it?
Yeah, they're aliens and they come from outer space.
Okay, we have a middle-aged, some sort of middle-aged scientist, typically with a young, beautiful girlfriend. There's a meteor that crashes. They go to check it out, which is very 50s style. It's in a desert community, of course, which is almost all these, like Them or Tarantula. Then later, the kind of homages like Tremors would do that. So they go to check it out. He discovers that with beneath kind of the rubble in the mountain, it's not a meteor, right? Just a typical, I don't know the difference. Is it a meteor? And then it's a meteorite when it enters the atmosphere. Sorry, guys. But
I do believe it's a meteor when it's in the sky, and when it
a
lands on
meteorite
the ground, it's meteorite because
it went through our atmosphere, something like that. So
itemized rock.
regardless, he discovers that it's not actually just that. It's a ship, and there's these weird creatures that come at you in 3D, which we did not get to watch it in
No.
3D, unfortunately, but it is supposed to be in 3D. He basically tells everyone, and typically no one believes him. These aliens are up to something we don't know, and there becomes the 50s paranoia that we all love from Invasion of the Body Snatchers or any other
Right.
science fiction movie, The Day the Earth Stood Still. Classic 50s paranoia ensues.
They end up like the aliens can look like you,
Yeah.
because they only made one costume. Maybe they want to make
If I
multiple.
was a perfect replica, how would you know I was me?
What is
That's
that?
the
Okay.
thing. So that's the not verbatim, but close enough. So it's kind of like that, a Body Snatchers kind of story, but which was later. Body
Yeah.
Snatchers was 56.
And the thing was obviously, the original thing might have been around the same time, but I don't think they took identity in that.
Like the best version of the thing is...
Stop, it's Horror Express, we know, you've said it 1,000 times. But anyways, this is very typical, but it is a little bit early in that cycle, so I got to give it props for that.
I would actually say that this is an atypical one, actually.
Would you?
I would. Well, one, this is a what's his name, Ray Bradbury?
Oh, yeah, Ray Bradbury.
It is a Ray Bradbury,
which kind of blows my mind.
More like...
The Halloween tree and Something Wicked This Way comes out, the more popular of the...
In this one, you know, it doesn't like necessarily have like those Ray Bradbury elements, but there are like small aspects of it. For one, the main character is kind of like an outcast of society. He lives alone in the desert. He has a relationship with like the town cutie.
But they also look at him like he's crazy.
Right. He's an eccentric scientist. And
of course, no one believes him.
Right. Well, it's not that no one believes him. It's just that the town doesn't understand what he is or what he's trying to do. And the sheriff at one point states, like, listen, nobody here likes you. Nobody here understands you. Therefore, they're afraid of you.
So, and that's exactly the kind of story that happens with the aliens.
Right. And then when the aliens come, their whole thing, because they are benevolent aliens, and it's a pretty...
So we think.
Right. So we think. And their whole shtick is, look, we just want to leave your planet. We would ask for your help, but we don't trust you. You wouldn't understand us. Therefore, you would despise us. And
it's an age old story. Yeah. 92. You envy us, and what you envy, you destroy. And they don't understand them. That's a little different, but still, it's similar. You don't understand it. It's different. They're scared of it.
And you know, but you know, I would say that it's atypical in the sense that, you know, especially with like a lot of these movies, it's they are different. They are terrifying. We have to destroy them. This, I think, calls into question that mentality.
Well, I think it's very in line with The Day the Earth Stood Still.
Very much so. Well, Day the Earth Stood Still is...
Well, no, it's honestly like, if you listen to us, we'll save you and you'll be saved, but we can't have you destroying the rest of the planet. Therefore, we have this fail-safe mechanism that if you fuck up, it's over.
If you fuck up, you enter a police state.
It's kind of like Dr. Strangelove. Like, we had the missile thing, but it's a, if you don't tell anyone about it, Dimitri.
Wait, what's oh, man, don't make me do the quote because I can't recall this one.
There's no fighting
anymore. Well, no, not that one. I can't think of it. Oh, well, maybe
so
next time.
You missed
time.
It. Yeah. Yeah, I don't know. I like this one. It is like, I guess you're a little, it's a little ahead of its time, but it has all those 50s qualities where everybody's overly friendly, like howdy doody, like, hello friend, how's it going?
Everybody
I'm having
knows
a great
other.
Day. And they're always smiling and laughing and good natured.
They all got one syllable names. They all wear their driving gloves.
even in the shower. That's the most obscure joke no one else
right,
no
one else
get,
gets that. Maybe
ever.
One person watching this.
I doubt
the
it.
One who made it.
Yeah, he might not watch it. So, but anyways, yeah, I like I said, I wasn't super happy, like, in love with it, but, like, I gotta give it props for being earlier than a lot of the other sci-fi movies that I was thinking of. It doesn't ever really capture the intense paranoia that, like, I think it wants you to go for. Not intense, but the doubt, you know? I think it's going for that a bit, but I never felt it was...
Yeah, I don't know if this is to make that paranoia. I think that it does, you know, throw in, like that idea of doubt, because the main character believes the aliens, and everybody else in the town is like, maybe you shouldn't.
Well,
like,
he feels related to them
he
because
does
he's
feel
the outcast. And also, well, there is that thing, too. Well, they're outcasts. They can take our shape. We don't know who the... They would say this in Invasion by Sleep. We don't know who the communist is.
Right.
We don't know who the... You know, that kind of style. I don't know if that's necessarily true, but it's a similar how they say the tropes of the slasher movie. They threw those things on there and those rules, and it all kind of applies to the 50s science fiction movies, too.
Right, but I think that the stronger point in this one is, like, it isn't so much the paranoia. I think it's more the trust. Because when the aliens, like, take the shape of someone, they take the other person, they keep them hostage. And, like, at one point, of course, they get the guy's girlfriend. And it's not like, you know, oh, are you my girlfriend or not? It's more like...
Is my girlfriend okay?
Is my girlfriend okay? If I leave you alone, will you return to her, or, like, return her to me unharmed? And it's that trust.
It's scary of having fate, you know?
Right.
Like, trusting somebody you don't really know that you feel is the right thing to do.
Right. And the sheriff, you know, like, makes a great point. He's like... Listen, I don't want that responsibility. We'll do it your way. And then, of course...
It backfires.
It backfires. And they had that whole thing about 92 degrees. Is it at 92 degrees? Like, is when people snap. It's like more
gunshots. Oh, yeah, that's a great moment where he's like, more people are killed at 92 degrees than any other temperature. And he speaks and he says, at anything cooler, people aren't as mad. And then he says, anything over 92, it's too hot to do anything. But right. 92 degrees is just the right temperature to be upset.
Right.
And it's so true. I work in a hot environment.
I work at 911.
No controlled environment. So, like, if it's 90, I have to work. So, if it's over 90 degrees and humidity, it's just snap. You're yelling at people. You're getting frustrated. Everybody's mad all the time. And then usually with warm weather comes overtime and that kind of business. So, everybody's ready to kill each other. But, you know what? I bumped this up. You know, I don't know what I was thinking. I like it a little bit more. And it's what sci-fi movies always get better the more you talk about it, the more you think about it.
Right.
Like, even like the newer ones and stuff. I would compare the characters to that of the Blob.
Like, very, yeah.
And then you have the deputy who really doesn't believe him, but he comes around. And I don't know. I do like the movie, and it's a little ahead of its time than I would expect. So
it's probably not my favorite Jack Arnold.
No. I would put Creature and Invasion of the Incredible Shrinking Man above it.
Right. I do really like Incredible Shrinking Man.
I mean, the Creature's perfect.
Creature is a perfect film.
And then Incredible Shrinking Man. She's all these in melting, shrinking. Right. Shrinking Man is a classic, too.
That's a good one. And then
Tarantula.
I don't know if I like it more or less than Tarantula.
I think it's a better story than Tarantula.
It is definitely a better movie than Tarantula, but I do feel that Tarantula is just...
Well, Bug Boy was born from
Tarantula. I don't know. And then there's the part where the tarantula's peeking in the house that the girl changes, being all pervy, like...
Pervy tarantula.
Right. For like, the win. Okay, what are we doing?
Let me grab the book. Sorry about that. Okay, so it's not in Tear on Tape, but it is in John Stanley's Creature Features, as it should be. So here we go. It came from outer space, 1953. 5 out of 5.
He gets a 5 out of 5?
Yes, okay. And Jack Arnold obviously was one of the... would you say pioneer? What'd you think about it? Like, I'm looking at all the sci-fi movies. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Even with the Universal stuff. And before we begin, I think your rating is probably lower because we waited an hour for pizza, and that usually affects your rating.
Stop it. One of the finest science fiction thrillers of the 1950s, inspired by a Ray Bradbury outline that was modified for Universal International by Harry Essex, and originally released in 3D. Essex's screenplay, while being among the first to portray benevolent aliens, is also a plea for better understanding between races. This is Jack Arnold's best directorial work, for he captures the desert eeriness as bug-eyed aliens crash-land their ship near astronomer Richard Carlson's isolated home. The ETs, dubbed xenomorphs, are giant eyeball creatures capable of assuming human forms. A fisheye lens is used to simulate the point of view of the creatures. Barbara Rush provides love interest, Charles Drake is the disbelieving sheriff, and Russell Johnson and Joe Sawyer are possessed telephone linemen. Known in the early stages as the Meteor, Atomic Monster, and Strangers from Outer Space, I did laugh hysterically. I thought it was really fun. This is the thing that clicked for me. I always knew that the Tremors and, you know, were throwbacks to the 50s sci-fi movies, but when the guy was on the power line up there and he was like, and he had this, like, this spiel, I was like, man, this reminds me so much of Tremors. Like, and I was like, Tremors literally is a throwback to the 50s sci-fi movie. And it was 1990, so it was that 80s carryover, because the 50s and the 80s, I think, are like...
They're the nostalgia.
Yeah, and I feel like the 80s were kind of, a lot of them were repping on the 50s, especially, like, Killer Clowns from Outer Space, and we had remakes and all that kind of stuff, felt very 50s-ish, throwbacks, The Bean. So, yeah, I would put Tremors in that, and I would put the desert setting as probably, well, Roswell and all that stuff. So, yeah, it's got to be with the science fiction movies.
I think it might have been cheaper to film in the desert, too. Less permits.
People think that. But I don't know if that's 100% true. It's awful hot in the day. It's awful cold at night. The water.
Yeah, but if
you got to travel far.
You don't got to travel far. You've been to California? LA to the desert's like 20 minutes.
Yeah, maybe.
That takes me a little more time to get to work because I piddle-paddle at the gas
station. LA to the desert? I don't think you can drive anywhere in California in 20 minutes.
Yeah, maybe
you
not.
You can't even get to the gas station in 20 minutes and a half a mile from the street. Anyways, 3.5, 7 out of 10 for me.
I would probably give this like a 4, maybe a 4.5 if I watched it again. I will say, I was a little bit let down by the alien design, because it really is just like a trash can of a bag over it.
It's better than, like it's better than Sting of Death.
I didn't see Sting of
Better
Death.
Better than Jellyfish Man from William
Pitt. Oh, Patel. Yeah.
Better than Sting of Death.
Oh, yeah.
But not quite as good as The Thing for me. It's the biggest spread. It's like,
right.
I just did it to be funny. Here's Sting of Death. here's The Thing from 1982.
And then here we got...
No, move that over closer to This Thing of Death. That's way closer to This Thing of Death. Yeah, that's the rating. Monster. We should do monster ratings. Right. The monster meter. Monster meter. We start with Sting of Death by William Gurfey, or even, and then we end on the John Carpenter's The Thing, and everything else is in between.
Right. We should make that.
The monster meter?
Yeah.
It'd be a good idea. So, Deadly Spawn is closer to The Thing.
Right. I don't like The Thing's design, though, because it's not a concrete design. I don't know.
We're doing the monster meter, and I'm already upset at you.
I think the Xenomorph should be at the top. I think those look really cool.
It's just an ant.
Ants are cool. Did you ever see Honey, I Shrunk the Kid?
Yes, I did.
Man, I cried when that ant died. I can't spoiler watch that movie. For yeah, spoiler for Honey, I Shrunk the Kid. From 35 years ago.
All right, next week is Hour of the Wolf, and then I think it might be Arsenic and Old Lace, and then it might be The Conjuring.
And then Martin.
No, I don't know. Martin and the Thirst are both in there, too. So I don't know what's going on.
But was I first pick? So
I don't know how many are left. There's like eight left.
There is not eight left.
Yes, there
I
is.
I can't do this eight more times. I'll tell you that Stop right now.
We're done. It's over.
Okay. Yeah, it is over. I'm done after this.
Okay, let's get into these questions. First, Todd E. Walnuts. Good stuff, Dave. How have you been? I've been good. How have you been? Check his channel out if you haven't. His comment will be right there on the video. Go ahead and click it. Check his channel out. He covers a lot of new releases and stuff like that as well. Travis Wright. It would be fun for y'all to do the Godzilla movies. That was the answer to the question. But he also asked a question. So if you had no electricity for 3 days, what would be the first movie you watched when the power came back on? I don't know. I probably would be so annoyed at everything. I couldn't relax when the power did come back on. I'd be like, oh, I gotta clean. I can finally make coffee pot again. I can make coffee pot. I'm just sitting here making coffee pots. But you guys know what I mean. So I probably wouldn't be like jazzing to watch a movie right away if my power was off for 3 days. I'd be very annoyed. Jeff, Bocamp, wait, Americans don't eat spaghetti in 3-piece suits while watching the Super Bowl? No, but that's obviously a joke comment about absurd or AKA horrible, which we're laughing about. And this is JK and TE, or whatever his name is, J Kitty. My one question for people regarding a Serbian film is, why would you watch it? Why would you subject yourself to simulated rape of a newborn baby? How is there anything of worth or merit to be extracted from that? I just don't understand it. For me, it doesn't matter if anyone was really hurt on the set or not, which I know they weren't. It's the notion of or intent. It'd be like a pedophile hangs around a school playground staring at kids but doesn't actually do anything. Would people be okay with that? I could find some artistic merit, like you said before, in some technical aspects of this film, but there's no redeeming features regarding story, character arc, or the film's plot devices. I'm yet to find anyone with a valid argument as to why this is a good film. Interesting to follow its ongoing lifespan, though. I will say that that much. And then we have a reply from Ilk Vomit. How is there anything of worth or merit to watching someone get their throat slit or eyes gouged out? It all comes with the territory in horror films. And besides, you pretty much know more or less what you're getting yourself into before you dive headfirst into extreme film. First, I do think that there is an interesting aspect. I mean, like, I think that back in the day, I grew up watching a lot of horror films and extreme films, so I was definitely desensitized to that stuff, always knowing it's fake, always knowing that it's just a movie, right? But I do feel that a lot of the people that are jumping down Serbian films' throat were the same people that were probably jumping down Cannibal Holocaust's throat, and I think that Cannibal Holocaust is more worthy of jumping down its throat for the real-life animal murders in it. It's just so weird what people pick and choose to get so mad about. I also feel like if this movie wasn't so well made, it wouldn't have garnered attention from the mainstream, and most people would have never even heard of it, because there is tons of extreme nasty movies that have subject matters that are awful like this, and people never mention them because they never ever heard of them. But I do think that the character arc is very interesting, because we have Milos, who's a porn star who degrades women on screen, so you're always kind of like, you know, you don't really particularly care for him. And at the same time, he genuinely loves his family and wants to do the right thing. So I feel like his character arc is interesting. He wants to make sure there's money, and he has to be put into this horrible situation, and he's always walking the line. I think that his brother is an interesting character, constantly being obsessed with, you know, his brother's family and this weird kind of obsession about it and stuff. I also think that the main villain, but the director is an interesting character, that he is one of these people that has become so obsessed with film and art and everything that he's went next level insane, and his idea of art and creation and all that that stuff is completely manipulated in the sick things like that. And if you notice that the Raza, his main goon, has the film tattoo on his neck, you can just see that these guys were possibly film fanatics that have went to that next level of insanity. They're like the Frank of Hellraiser. Like, nothing was ever enough. No art statement was ever enough. And it's just a weird kind of thing to think about, honestly. And then they're being manipulated too. So it's just a weird kind of thing like that. I think there's lots of interesting characters in the film. I think that they do have character arcs, somewhat. Although I'm not sure 100% if the director ever realizes what, you know, anything different from what he is. And also, it's all fake. Like, it's so weird that people are like, I'm okay with them, you know, raping a woman over a rock for an hour and a half. But the second I know it, it's just, it's weird. It's so weird, the cutoff line. And it's probably because the uncomfortability of it. It all makes me uncomfortable to a certain extent. Like, but I do like movies to have an impact on me. And I will never jump down anybody's throat that doesn't want to watch this or anything like that. I completely understand that you want nothing to do with this movie, you and everything like that, and that's fine. But at the same time, you got to understand that some people, you know, they don't look at extreme films different. Also, I know that people like Stephen Biro that run on Earth, they like to see things that mess with them. You know, people do like to get a response from the films they watch. They like to be disturbed or and stuff like that. So I think there is a merit within that. Or the film's plot devices, the way the script structure is very unique, and the fact that he's going through and actually like finding the tapes and watching the tapes, and it's I don't know, it's interesting too. So there's lots of stuff to think of the movie, and also the soundtrack is good. I know you said only the technical aspects, but the whole way that the script unfolds structurally, and honestly, that the people being like, I can't see why anybody would want to watch this, they just sound a lot like the people that were complaining about the video nasties in the 70s. And I don't know, it's so weird to walk the line to be a very, like, I feel like I'm very accepting of so many people, and I never want to hurt anyone's feelings or go about that, but at the same time, it's hard to, like, because I know films can upset people, but I am completely against censorship, you know? So I'm always caught in a between a hard place and a rock, because I understand that the subject matter is bothersome to some people, but I'm against the censorship, and I watch the weird stuff and the crazy stuff, and I don't like real snuff or anything, or real animal deaths. But as far as a film is, it's only a movie. It's only a movie. It's only a movie, right? So then we have Nick Mua, question of the week. Since the past year has been such a downer, perhaps you and your brother from another mother, Jeremy, could cover horror comedies to spread some cheer. That is a good, because he's answering the question of the week, which I mixed him up a little bit this week, so sorry. And then his question of the week. A lot of slashers seem to focus on younger people, teens, 20-something young adults, people in their early 30s, which are the, it says younger people, teens, or 20-something young adults, people in their early 30s. Which of the above do you prefer? Would slasher featuring older people work? Homebodies is kind of a slasher featuring older people, a little different. I wouldn't mind seeing older characters in some slasher movies. There is that sometimes. I don't know. Lately, slashers have not been very good for me, so I don't want to ever see any teen slashers made in modern times, to be honest. They just don't work for me. Sorry. I know that Final Girls is great because it's a parody or a take on the genre, but after Scream, it was really hard to make a slasher with teens and have anything decent in it. There's a couple I like, but mix up the characters. Like, I mix them up. Throw some different kind of, you know, people in there. Don't make them college kids. Like, I was just thinking about, like, what if they, we talked about this before, me and Dustin and Brandon, what if in Zombievers, instead of them killing kids, it was them zombie beavers or lumberjacks? Better movie. Then we have here, you once discussed the camera technique in Dario Argento's Tenebrae. I believe you liked it. I sure did. I love it. When does camera technique become too elaborate for you or rub you the wrong way? It's mostly editing techniques or like whip pans that never stop and fight scenes. They kind of get old to me. But there's a, what's that, Krasnov? What's the, it is a really crazy Russian film. I'm looking for it on the shelf. Krasnov, My Car. The camera work in that movie, the same guy did the Hard to Be a God. His camera work is show-offy, but I love it. So I don't know if I can't get tired of his camera work, I don't think I'll get tired of anybody's camera work as long as it's well done. So no, just because something's hard to do doesn't make it great, but sometimes I'm sucked into the gimmick of how good it is or weird or crazy it is. How do you feel Salo, 120 Days of Sodom, compares to a Serbian film? Is one nastier than the other, equally nasty? ooh, different. I think Sal is a little harder for me to watch because I feel like the pacing is slower, so maybe you get caught more into it, and it's more based on a real story, even though in Serbian film that stuff does happen. But for some reason in Sallow, like, it's just, I don't know. I don't know. I remember watching it and being, like, kind of disturbed by it. It's been a long time since I've watched it. I really like the new arrangement of your collection. It seems gone forever and ever and ever, Mr. Kubrick would say. Hope that the creepy old dude isn't hanging around Casa Parker anymore. Could have been a Romero-type zombie. No, he was just some poor old guy. I wish I'd have never brought him up. David Leather, you guys seen Big Man Japan? We have not. I'll check. I'll look into it. And then answers I asked basically what you wanted me and Jeremy to cover for after this blind spot. I think we have a general idea what we want to do, but Ilk Vomit, I will always champion for you and Jeremy to cover the Godzilla franchise. Now I've heard practically everything there is to hear about every movie myself, but I haven't heard yours and his opinion, so something I would always want. Very cool. I definitely want to do them eventually. Peek and Boo, question of the week. Surprise us. Pick what you want, but if you find out the hentai tentacle anime Twin Angels from 1994, I think it went out of print for the third time 3 years ago, or I might have misunderstood your question if you meant movie studios, certain genres. Okay, sorry again for the long text. Be safe. Okay. Zach Nolan, I wait on actual pins and needles for your preferred at Film Fest. Please review The Haunting of Julia or Phantom Thread. Both I want to see. Then we have Jason Fetters. Universal Horror would be a great choice after Hammer Time. Personal, Peter Engelin, John Jaco's Anno's Quest for Fire, and In the name of the Rose. Samuel Fuller's Shot Quarter, and Naked Kiss, and A Big Red One. Yeah, I love The Big Red One. It's been years since I've watched it. I would have rewatched it, but I want to watch the extended cut, but only the regular cut is on Blu-ray. My hair is driving me nuts, if you guys haven't noticed. It's like at the right length to look crazy, man. I need a haircut, so I got to get one maybe next week or something. But yeah, I'd like to watch more Sam Fuller movies for sure. David Luton, Universal would be great, or make Jeremy watch classics like Psycho that he claims he's never seen before. And Jeremy responds, no, brother. Okay, so Derek B, he picks Apes, which we definitely want to watch the rest of the Planet of the Apes movies. Jeremy R, I get to pick the entire list, all stock, 52 films curated to my taste that would gradually shed light as to why I am the monster you think I am and where my fate ultimately lies. Side note, it's just gonna be secret in them 52 times. Josh Hayes, how about Giallo films, segments like you did with Hammer Time? That would be sick. I would love to do that, but Giallo films bleed together a lot, so I feel like I would be getting plots, devices, and twists confused. Ron Monster, Drew, he basically said, do it, and showed a Godzilla gif. Jonathan Wilhelm, gotta go through the Universal sets. Sean Donahue, fetish porn. I'm damn close at this point, right? I did the Nakatsu Erotic Films movies. I'll probably do more. I'm really close. I did the Encounters of the Unknown. So then comments. Isimisio, yep, I agree on the Serbian film. For me, the disturbing elements added to the narrative and isn't there just for shock value or fluff. It's a really well-made film, where you sympathize with the characters and their motives, especially towards the end when you wish it could worked out differently for them. Speaking of movies that seem to be disturbing for disturbing sake, I just watched Satan's Blood last night. Enjoyed the first half an hour, then it got weird towards the middle, with the orgy scene and the oils. And the third act was just hodgepodge of complete and utter craziness. When the story hardly makes sense, it takes me out of it. If it does make sense and there are disturbing elements that help to illustrate the story characters, then I don't see a problem with it at all. You and Jeremy should review The Unholy Women 2006. I'm not sure if that movie is exactly Jeremy's taste, so my apologies, Jeremy. Haha. It sounds interesting. Logan Gaming 15. I love Serbian film. Simon Henderson. Awesome review of Serbian film, man. My most extreme films are hard to watch just because of production values, let alone the content, unless you're a fan. Also, much of these films are relatively hard to find unless you're a fan. Looks and sounds great. A Serbian film looks and sounds great, which I guess is part of the reason it sort of crossed over into the mainstream. It surprises me how many people are aware of the film, but not new extreme cinema themselves. But make no mistake, this is one of the big dogs of those sort of films. I bet it left a lot of people feeling a little broken and dirty inside after watching it. I thought it was cool. Peek and Boo, this episode, man, now you really need to print that pervert card, or maybe Ichi, which is Japanese, it means the same thing, holy water or something. Never even heard of White Rose Campus before. Hides under bed in shame. I mean, I don't think it's a very mainstream movie. Agreed on Serbian film. It's a Serbian film. It's a masterpiece and so mean and nihilistic. Chaos, that line. Their first, she had two holes. Now she's got one big one. And the scene itself is just so sick. Great movie, though. Yeah, it makes me want to throw up. They celebrate Christmas in Japan. It is more for friends to meet and party, whereas New Year's is for the family. Here's how the Christmas can be. Looks so cute. Then he posts a video. Japan has adopted quite much from the USA after World War II. Halloween is popular there also for party and fun. Also, a lot of Japanese horror movies are inspired by the Western world stories, added with the special Japanese stuff to it. Adam Watson, cool, I love Chaos. I mean, it's a brutal movie, but I think it's awesomely shocking and well-made. Domino D, well, this is an extreme week, no doubt about that. I haven't ever seen a Serbian film, and I don't know if I ever will. Sounds like it has some aspects and sounds interesting, but it also has aspects that I am not sure I can watch. Maybe one day. I do want to check out White Rose Campus, though. I am starting to watch more Asian cinema, and this sounds interesting enough. I am in a group that hated Chaos. I don't remember why I hated it, but I just did at the time. Maybe I need to watch it again to see if my opinion has changed. No, I do understand, like, I don't have kids, too, so, like, that, like, I don't know, maybe I'd feel completely different with Serbian film if I had kids, and I probably would. Replica Maze, hey, I edited that White Rose Campus trailer, thank you, awesome. Rainbow Fox, wow, this guy's been going for 8 years, and he's still going, what a legend. Thank you. And then Advice Column Foes, dude just loves to talk, and it's like, I guess so, right? Matt James, Homage? Come on, man. Chaos is a blatant ripoff of Last House. That very well may be, but one of the producers on it was Junior from the original, and originally this movie started as a remake. Something happened where it had to be kind of a homage, in his words, so I don't want to call it a ripoff because it started off as a kind of a remake, and I do feel it's more true to the spirit of the original than the remake itself is. So, yeah, maybe it is a ripoff, but whatever. And then Fidelio, he basically commented on the Hostel review, and I want to kind of address this so people don't get the wrong idea. People were using, basically I complained about Hostage using the gay slurs. People were using that kind of language in Hostel still when I was in high school and in my early 20s during the first half of the 2010s. My friend's 12-year-old nephew recently said to me after I recommended a video game to him that, nah, that's gay. So it's not like the young people still don't talk like that. It was totally accurate in 2005. It's bizarre you called it dated when you're on a podcast with three guys who talk like that jokingly through most of their time on this platform. Other than the whole portion of this video, which was so confusing to me, this is great content as usual. I appreciate that, but I just have to address this. Like, I feel somewhat hypocritical, to be honest, at times, because I don't use those words myself, and there's people that I know that I'm friends with that do use the words in a joking way, more so even parodying it. But I know that those words can be hurtful to people. And every time I hear someone use it, I'm not offended. I cringe and I'm embarrassed. Like, I'm like, ah, oh, that's such, it just, it makes them sound dumb to a certain extent. And I know, like, and it makes them seem like I don't want other people to get the wrong idea that they're hateful people. And I know a lot of people do. So it makes me think that, man, I'm a, you know, sometimes I feel like a hypocrite or an idiot for, you know, or for not saying anything. And I do understand that Hostel, people do talk like that. Maybe it's just a product of its time so much that, you know, it's just seeing like the main characters talk like that. Usually the people from the 80s, like side characters talk like that, maybe have one or two. But anyways, I've never been one to be upset at what other people do. I just carry myself the way I do. I just don't want to fight battles and especially burn bridges over something that I know is not somebody's intent, if that makes any sense. Maybe I'll bring it up. I know that I do cringe every time I hear people use it. And I know there's other people that use it in jokes and joking terms and stuff. And I've said, you know, jokes and things like that, but I never use the words like that because I find them inappropriate. And all in general, like, I don't, you know, it's just a strange thing to bring up, and I don't want people to get the wrong idea. So it's just a weird line to walk when, you know, you do a podcast and you joke around and people say things that you may find offensive, or you don't want other people to misconstrue what they mean or how they take it. So you're like, you're almost like, come on. But at the same time, you know that they don't mean it like that, but other people don't see it that way. And like I said, it can be hypocritical at times. Like, also, it's like working in a work environment when you hear somebody say something that's just like inappropriate as hell, but you just don't want to. It's like being a coward. You're like, I don't want to bring this up or say anything because, you know, it's just life is miserable enough without having to fight every 3.5 seconds. So I guess that call me a coward, say I'm a hypocrite or whatever, but it is what it is. And I just wanted to address it because it does bother me that to a certain extent. And like, this is going to bring me into the question of the week. Because I know, that people do talk like that. It just felt so weird. I guess maybe it's just too realistic at the time, for Hostel to talk like that and have characters talk like that. But I just know that when I was in college, I was at a community college, dummy college, I guess, in 2006. And nobody really talked like that anymore. And I remember in like 7th, 8th grade, maybe sometimes in high school it was brought up, but it kind of just faded out, especially with my friends now, like my friends I hang out in person. Nobody really brings it up or says it anymore, unless it's like parroting people that would say it. So it's just a strange situation, to be honest. And I wanted to address it because I don't want people to get the wrong idea. Like I'm not ever trying to come across as a bigot or anything like that. But, hey, it is what it is, and I don't want people to see me in that light. But if they do, they will. And also, I still do cringe. The first act of Hostel, I cringe. Like, it just is like, eh. And also the fact that, like, Eli Roth, like, defended it in the Fangoria magazine and did a really piss-poor job of doing it, made him sound worse. And the idea that, like, this isn't, like, your side character, this is, like, the main character. And there's also an aspect in there about one of the characters questioning his sexuality, so it makes sense that that would constantly be brought up. Boom, boom, boom. So he would feel even more uncomfortable with his friends and coming out to them. And they definitely do point that out in there. So I think maybe that it could be misconstrued in that film as well. But then he has Green Inferno, which came out like 10 years after, and the characters that are supposed to be social justice warriors are talking like that too. So I'm like, I don't understand. Like, I don't think that social justice warriors in 2016 talk like that at all. So, but anyways, it's supposed to be kind of a comment on them too, being hypocrites. Anyways, it's a touchy subject and it's a weird subject. And I don't hold like movies like John Wayne saying stuff or Italian movies for being obviously, you know, hitting women and stuff, hold it against them because they're products of their time. And Hostel is a product of its time as well. And I won't hold that against its final rating or if it's a good movie or not, but I will bring it up that it does feel a little awkward in the first act for sure. And it just is like, it makes me cringe. So it's just like, oh, it feels very 2005-ish. I guess it just didn't, the first act didn't age very well for me. Well, the rest of the movie did age very well. So just the way it is. So the question of the week is there any movie that is particularly dated in such a bad way it makes you uncomfortable? Now, this could be a lot of things, like just the way characters are portrayed. If it's a 50s sci-fi movie where it's like all the female characters are basically, you know, secretaries or just in bikinis. And I know that a lot of the 50s sci-fi movies were more progressive with it. They actually had like female doctors and stuff, which is cool. So any movie that is so badly dated, it makes you uncomfortable. And I, like I said, I'm always one to be like, hey man, those movies were made at a different time. And you got to take that in consideration, most definitely. So, but I'm just curious, is there any movie that's particularly dated in such a bad way it makes you uncomfortable? So, I guess we're going to hop into the update. Okay, so let's start this out with the 4K. There's only one of them, but it's a biggie. It is Demons 1 and 2 from Arrow Video. I love these movies. I got a 4K TV coming Thursday, a QLED. I'm going to probably watch something like Demons and Dawn of the Dead in 4K on the new TV. But, yeah. This is a 4K Ultra HD of 1 and 2. I love it. I love Demons, by the way. It's one of my favorite movies ever made. Then we have the Criterion Flash Sale. I don't know if I can zoom out enough to show this sucker. So there we go. I don't want to mess it up. But it is the Godzilla Showa era films, 1954 to 1975. It's like a big book. A lot of people are mad about this. I think it's cool. I don't like these typically, these crazy editions, because they're always hard to store and I'm worried about messing them up. But it's a cool edition nonetheless. I'm going to leave it sitting down there and get back in track here. Sorry. You're going to be seeing Godzilla on the bottom of everything now. And then we have a Criterion that came. It was on Amazon. This wasn't from the flash sale, but it's a Blow Up. Antonioni. I know this movie's heavily inspired so many movies like Blowout and Deep Red and Dario Argento and stuff like that. So, boom. Definitely had to get that. Then we have The Innocents from the sale. I kind of went crazy and just bought like a lot of the horror titles that I didn't have. So this one's very popular. Got a good reputation. Then we have The Uninvited. Another classic. Next time I might go for samurai movies or something. Then we have House, which I have on DVD. Never watched it. I hear lots of great things. Very excited to watch this one. This one has been on my want to watch list for years. And then we have War of the Worlds, the original classic movie, which I've never seen. It should have been on my blind spot. That's That's very embarrassing, right? And then we have Eyes Without a Face. This is a great movie. We watched it for Blindspot. It did not have the Blu-ray. Now I do have the Blu-ray. Yeah, Cat People. I've seen the remake, enjoy it, but I've never seen the original. Can't wait. I bet it's great. I know it's great. I've heard lots of good things. Then we have Seconds, John Frankenheimer movie. Always wanted to watch this one. Always sounded very interesting to me. Always had a great idea and concept behind it. And then we have the Bruce Lee set. Finally, right? His greatest hits. Bruce Lee, I'm not super familiar with his movies, you know. But this has The Big Boss, The Fist of Fury, The Way of the Dragon, Enter the Dragon, and Game of Death. Criterion putting out Bruce Lee. I love seeing that kind of stuff. But the last Blu-ray, and then we're going to kind of dive down. I'm going to change the angle just because there's no room right now, is the Pang Brothers film Recycle on Blu-ray. The Pang Brothers did the iMovies. So, yeah. And then we're going to kind of hop down here into some DVDs that I bought. I got these from my friend. Pretty good price on them. This one I already have on Blu-ray, but it's Dead or Alive, the final. I have the Arrow set. He hooked me up. Good deal on a lot of these. Very cheap. And then we have the MPD Psycho, the first edition right here. What is this one? Volume 1. Directed by Takashi Miike. They're all mixed up. I'm sorry. I'm going to mix these up. It'll drive me nuts otherwise. Then we have MPD Part 2. It's a TV series Takashi Miike did. Then we have Part 3, of course. All still have their slip covers. Very cool. I've never seen these. Very excited to check them out if I ever have the time. And then we have The Way to Fight, which is, I think it's a Takashi Miike film, yeah, too. Yeah, Tokyo Shock put this out. Then we have The Great Yoki War from 2005 by Takashi Miike. Whoa, looks nuts. I know there's a two-disc edition of that, too. Then we have The Agitator, another Miike movie. 150-minute international version. Cool. And then last, we have Deadly Outlaw Rika, which is another Takashi Miike movie. In a gross blockbuster case. And then I went ahead and ordered one of the $50 ship sets with 30 of these Asian movies again. And I got more doubles. I think I should have probably just let it stay where I was at ahead. But here we go. So we got Red Wolf, Action Pack 2 disc set. Did not have this from the director Iron Monkey. So that was a good buy, I guess. There's one. Then we have Female Scorpion. Convict Scorpion. Already had that one. So seems like a lot of doubles. Then we have some cut sides. We have Lady Kusama Collection 1. Put them back in the box. Then we have Yakuza Hunters Final Death Ride Battle. I think I already had this one as well. So, like I said, I started getting a lot of doubles in this one. So, I took a second chance. Lady plus Ninja 2. Then we have Samurai School, Be a Man. I think I got this one as well. So, like I said, I probably only got a handful of new titles, but it wasn't super expensive. Then we have Gojo, Inherit War Chronicle, Asano in here. Got that one last time, too. I already covered that one. Then we have Id. Already had it. We have Family 2. Already had it. So maybe I'll do a giveaway for the patrons or something and you get a bunch of Asian movies. And then Kamikaze Taxi. Again, already had it. In that last box too. Then Death Bell, Bloody Camp. I think that one was in the last box too. So it's like a lot of freaking repeats this time. But it's okay. Tomy, Revenge, which I had, but it wasn't in the last box. I just had it. And then we have Zatoichi, Volume 1, which was in the last box. Terror Taxi, which I don't think I had. I might have had this, but I'm not 100% sure. It most definitely was not in the last box. Then we have Tomy, The Beginning. So both Tomy movies are in here, which is cool. Then we have Love, Ghost, which I did not have. I don't think so. So that's a good buy. Samurai Resurrection, which I don't think was in the box. But it gets very hard when there's 30 titles with Samurai in it. This one was definitely in the box. Samurai Chicks. My arms aren't long enough. Black Angel 2 in the box last time. Kiri in the box last time. This one was not in the box, but I do have it, but I did not have the deluxe edition here. This is Witchboard, the really heavy double disc edition, so that's a good buy. Very cool. And what else do we have here? Saddam the Killer. I had that one last time. Or Sodom. And this one as well. The Dimension Travelers. This one I think was in the last box. End Call. And then this home stretch here. We have Shinobi, which I think was in the box. Gun Crazy, A Woman from Nowhere, which I don't think was in the box, but I think I do have it. And then Jungle Juice, which was in the box. How could I forget Jungle Juice? And Shinobi, A Way Out, which I think was also in the box. So, like I said, I got like 5 or 6 titles, maybe more. Maybe 10 I didn't have. So, it's not too bad of a loss. But, yeah, let's hop back to the video.
Okay, guys, thank you very much for watching. And as always, have a good one.